Communication is not words. Communication is architecture. Because of course it is quite obvious that a house which would be built without the sense, without that desire for communication, would not look like your house looks today. Mark Z. Danielski's father, Tad, on his sister's Pose song, Wild, on the album Haunted. Hi, this is Carla, and welcome back to There Might Be Cupcakes. This is episode 68, Bone-Chimes and Primitive Spiders. And it's the first episode in the new House of Leaves series. I've hopefully designed the series so that you can listen and enjoy it for what it is without ever reading the book, but that I also won't give too much away if you intend on reading the book but haven't yet. Nice balance. Bigger on the Inside is a little joke in our culture, and it usually makes people think of Doctor Who's TARDIS, the blue police box the good doctor uses to traverse time and dimensions to make things right. But what if it referred to your home in the worst way possible? What if you or your children could get lost in your own home? Home, the very word, is supposed to invoke thoughts and feelings of safety, coziness, and knowing where everything is. That's exactly why haunted house and home invasion horror is so scary, and so satisfyingly scary. We can rehearse the worst what if from the comfort of our safe and comfy couch or bed, and then leave it behind. House of Leaves goes way beyond. It tells the story of an unsafe house, a demented domicile, the phrase I coined a while back for houses that are just not right, for whatever reason, capital letters, and then goes even deeper. The story of that unsafe house, that of the Navidson family. The story itself is cursed, demented itself. The Navidson record, as it's known, is both a hard-to-find video recorded by the Navidson family and a sheaf of papers, photos, and drawings collected by someone about the Navidson record video. The book House of Leaves is designed to look like this sheaf of documents. It actually started as a stapled-together group of documents passed around by the author, Danielski's friends. This stapled bunch is still listed as one of the editions on the copyright page. There are four editions, not counting anniversary editions. I own, and am using for these podcast episodes, the second edition of the color edition. The incomplete edition is the original. It was privately distributed amongst friends, as I said. It's missing Chapter 21, Appendix 2, Appendix 3, and the index. It has no color in it. The black and white version. Color is not used for any words. There is no braille in the text, and there are only black and white images. The two-color edition, the one I own, as I said, the second edition of this one. The word house appears in blue throughout. Struck-out passages and the word minotaur appear in red. There is no braille in the text, and there are black and white and color images. The full-color edition. The word house appears in blue throughout. Struck-out passages and the word minotaur appear in red. And the only struck-out word in Chapter 21 appears in purple. It has braille and full-color plates. It has braille and full-color plates. To further enrich the rabbit hole experience that this novel truly is, it has a companion album by the author's sister, the singer Poe, which I quoted at the beginning. It's called Haunted, and the tracks all relate to parts of the novel. Note, you can listen to this remarkable album without spoiling the novel, but listening to it while reading the novel is an uncanny experience. I quoted her lyrics at the beginning of the episode, and I'll be quoting them throughout the series. This album is linked in the show notes on Apple, Spotify, and Amazon. The album was released on Halloween on the same year, 2000, as the novel, which was released, well, I'll talk about that in just a moment. You'll hear two men talking on the album. The storytelling man on the last song, the Hey Pretty remix, is Mark himself. The other man, who I quoted at the beginning of this episode, with this old-timey radio announcer voice, whose sound is reminiscent of the narrator in Rocky Horror Picture Show. That man is Tad Danielewski, Mark and Poe, nee Annie's, father. This huge project of novel and album were inspired by Tad's death. Apparently their father recorded himself and them in their childhoods and after. Some of the recordings are quite odd and haunting. To enrich the world of synchronicity, dates, coincidences of House of Leaves, today is the 21st anniversary of its publication. And I didn't initially do this on purpose. I got this idea of a series of episodes deep diving into this world as I reread this novel when I found my copy, which has been hiding from me for some time, several days ago. I posted officially on Facebook, Reddit, Litzy, Instagram a couple of days ago, and I started working on it yesterday with the plan to publish today, and then I turned to the copyright page to take notes on the different editions. March 7th. The Navidson record will get you. Eerie. Welcome to the Jungian mindfuck. There's definitely a level of what they call high strangeness around this novel. On that note, yes, I'm going to mark this series as explicit, for the sake of Apple Podcasts specifically. That way I can talk about sex, murder, and missing people, and use quotes with curse words and vulgar references without upsetting them. That's not to say that this is going to get raunchy, just that this is a horror novel. So let's be careful so that my episodes aren't removed from any platform, and so that y'all can choose which little pitchers with big ears listen to which episodes. Now, the book itself, it's fat. Ironically, it seems fatter than its 710 pages belie. Bulging with the paranormal, perhaps? It looks more like King's The Stand or It, like it's bulging with more information than is on its pages. The book's black cover has a tone-on-tone labyrinth printed on it that you can't see in every light. Yes, this is that book in which every single detail is extremely important. The inside cover has a garish collage of ephemera, which looks like it might have some blood on it. There's a measuring tape and a ruler, Edgar Allan Poe stamps, what looks to be dark strands of hair, sleeping pills, and a broken compass. The title page reads, Mark Z. Danielewski's House of Leaves, by Zampano, with introduction and notes by Johnny Truant. Note, the name Zampano is said to be Spanish in the text, and the final O has a grave accent on it. I'm not certain I'm pronouncing it correctly, so please hit me up using the contact or social media info in the show notes to correct me if I'm not. Then you turn to the copyright page, which explains in detail the four different editions, and an editor's note, which explains further that the first edition existed as stapled together pages circulated among close friends. Then the eerie dedication page, or rather, anti-dedication page. In typewriter font, the dedication page reads as a warning. This is not for you. A note before we begin the introduction, typed by Johnny Truant and completed on Halloween 1998 in Hollywood, California. I am approaching this book the way I do others on this podcast. I'm avoiding outright spoilers, as I said before, so that you can read it yourself, but I will be discussing it and reading quotes. For example, in this episode, I'm discussing Johnny's introduction slash testimony of sorts. There are a couple of revelations in it that I'm purposely leaving out for you to find for yourself, plus several clever turns of phrase and jokes. But I am talking about how his introduction is about how he came across the written portion of the Navidson record, which starts the book proper and leads you into reading it for yourself. I will continue in this fashion, skimming the surface, sort of. I want to share enough that you want to read it with me, but not so much that you can't. Fair enough? Also, each episode's title will come from either a quote from the book or a quote from Poe's lyrics. This episode's title is a portent, revealed in a moment. So, the book continues into Johnny's introduction, still in typewriter font, and it begins, I still get nightmares. Johnny talks about how his friend Lude introduced him to this elderly character named Zampano, no other name, in Lude's apartment complex, who then died suddenly. So yes, this book written as an exploration of grief and loss, which is in so much of horror, specifically the grief and loss of the author's father, begins with the death of an old man. Poe's album Haunted also begins with her father's death in the song Exploration B, That title will make sense once we begin reading the Navidson record itself. It refers to exploring the inside of the Navidson house, which is bigger on the inside. The song begins with the phone ringing, then its lyrics in its entirety are as follows. I thought you should know, Daddy died today. He closed his eyes and he left here at 12:03. He sends his love. He wanted you to know he isn't holding a grudge. And if you are, you should let go. Pick up, please, Mom. Hello? So back to poor nightmare-ridden Johnny Truant. Lude called Johnny at 3 a.m. to come over. He had to show him something. Johnny Truant immediately feels like something is wrong. Quote, I should have turned around right then. I should have known something was up. At the very least, sensed the consequence lingering in the air, in the hour, in Lude's stare, in all of it. And fuck, I must have been some kind of moron to have been so oblivious to all the signs. The way Lude's keys rattled like bone chimes as he opened the main gate, the hinges suddenly shrieking as if we weren't entering a crowded building but some ancient moss-eaten crypt. Or the way we padded down the dank hallway buried in shadows, lamps above hung with spangles of light that I swear now must have been the work of gray, primitive spiders. Or probably most important of all, the way Lude whispered when he told me things, things I couldn't give a damn about back then, but now, well, my nights would be a great deal shorter if I didn't have to remember them. So this is how Johnny and the reader are introduced to the written portion of the Navidson record. On Zapano's floor, beside four impossible claw marks in the wood. Quote, as I discovered, there were reams and reams of it, endless snarls of words, sometimes twisting into meaning, sometimes into nothing at all, frequently breaking apart, always branching off into other pieces I'd come across later, on old napkins, the tattered edge of an envelope, once even on the back of a postage stamp, everything and anything but empty, each fragment completely covered with the creep of years and years of ink pronouncements, layered, crossed out, amended, handwritten, typed, legible, illegible, impenetrable, lucid, torn, stained, scotch-taped, some bits crisp and clean, others faded, burned, or folded and refolded so many times, the creases have obliterated whole pages of God knows what. Sense, truth, deceit, a legacy or prophecy or lunacy or nothing of the kind. And in the end, achieving, designating, describing, recreating, find your own words. I have no more, or plenty more, but why? And all to tell what? And it all gave off a horrible feeling. Quote, one thing's for sure, even without touching it, both of us slowly began to feel its heaviness, sense something horrifying in its proportions, its silence, its stillness, even if it did seem to have been shoved almost carelessly to the side of the room. I know a moment came when I felt certain its resolute blackness was capable of anything, maybe even of slashing out, tearing up the floor, murdering Zapano, murdering us, maybe even murdering you. Then Johnny takes it home and reads it. Because of course he does. Curiosity drives a lot of horror. Johnny even makes a joke about it, referencing a Stone song. The humor in this book is extremely clever, and I'll be leaving most of it for you to discover yourself. And then, after circling back around to his nightmares and how haunted he is, he presents the actual documents for you to read for yourself. The next page is almost blank, except for the phrase, mise-en-scène. I first thought this was a play on the words mise-en-scène and mus, meaning to mess up. So, chaos in the representative scene of the whole book. But then I played around with the translator app on my phone, and mise-en-scène is German for must it be. Given how multi-layered this novel is, both might be true. I'll leave you here for now at the end of Johnny Truant's introduction and warnings. In the next episode, we'll delve into the structure of the novel, the social phenomenon the novel was when it was first published, and we'll dive into the Navidson record itself, and who the Navidson family was, nightmares be damned. But for now, I'll leave you with some apt Poe lyric. Remember, I've linked to the Haunted album in the show notes, and I've also linked to the book as well. Be careful when looking for it on your own, because there is a book called House of Blue Leaves by John Gare. No bueno. But first, a note on names. If you're a longtime listener, you know how I love names and their meanings. Lude puts into mind Quaaludes, the infamous downer drug. And Lude is a bad influence. Johnny Truant. He's a club kid who works at a tattoo shop. Not a tattoo artist, he just works there. You could argue he is truant to his own life. And Johnny isn't any guy name, and John puts in mind prostitution. And you could argue Johnny pimps this book out to us. Maybe I'm playing too much, but there it is. Also, one of Poe's singles from her first album was Angry Johnny. The lyrics saying, "Angry Johnny, this is Jezebel in hell. I want to kill you." It's insinuated that this Johnny is a womanizer, and you'll see from reading the introduction that Johnny Truant isn't exactly good with or to women. There's a list of the 7 women Zapano loved in his life, and I recognize many of them from classic literature, like Dante's Beatrice or Beatrice. I love the Italian pronunciation of Beatrice. And then there's Zapano. I knew I'd seen that unusual name before, and then I realized it. It's from that Fellini movie that slayed me when I saw it at Yale, La Strada. Zapano is a brutish strongman played by Anthony Quinn. Gelsomina, a young girl, learns that her sister Rosa died while performing on the road with Zapano. Zapano returns and purchases Gelsomina from her mother and teaches her to perform with him. Fascinating choice. I think we'll see this choice of a name play out as I reread the book, and you perhaps read it for the first time. I'll see you soon as we start exploring the hunt for the Navidson record, the film, the home movie that supposedly shows a 5.5-minute long hallway, a house that's bigger on the inside, urban legend or paranormal find of a lifetime. And if it's not real, then where's the Navidson family? Basically, this is the Blair Witch Project, but it's in your house and it's in your head, and it's so much more. Get ready to be haunted. And here's the lyrics to Poe's Haunted. Another reason I chose this episode's title, notice the web reference in the song. Also a note, several lyric sites and Apple Music have the last line spoken by a little girl as "I will go mad." But I definitively hear "I won't go mad," which makes sense to me. She sounds so defiant. Let me know what you hear. I'm going to read it as "won't," because like I said, the little girl sounds so defiant that just makes sense to me. Come here, pretty please. Can you tell me where I am? Won't you say something? I need to get my bearings. I'm lost, and the shadows keep on changing, and I'm haunted by the lives that I have loved and actions I have hated. I'm haunted by the lives that wove the web inside my haunted head. Don't cry. There's always a way. Here in November, in this house of leaves, we'll pray. Please, I know it's hard to believe, to see a perfect forest through so many splintered trees. You and me, and these shadows keep on changing. I'm haunted by the promises I've made and others I have broken. I'm haunted by the lives that wove the web inside my haunted head. Hallways, always. I'll always love you. I'll always need you. I'll always want you, and I will always miss you. Come here. No, I won't say please. One more look at the ghost before I'm going to make it leave. Come here. I've got the pieces here. Time to gather up the splinters and build a casket for my tears. I'm haunted by the hallways in this tiny room, the echoes there of me and you, the voices that are carrying this tune. What is it, Annie? You think I'll cry? I won't cry. My heart will break before I cry. I won't go mad.